Hi. Today's South Dakota adventure takes us to the Black Hills National Cemetery near Sturgis. This area, on the edge of the Black Hills, was once a part of Old Fort Meade during the early days of Dakota history. It was set aside after World War II as a cemetery for South Dakotans and other Americans who had given their lives defending American freedoms from the Civil War to Vietnam. On today's South Dakota adventure, we'll walk the path that leads to this final resting place for so many brave South Dakotans, some of whom served before there even was a South Dakota. The first notable example came early in the history of Dakota Territory, when Governor Jayne issued a proclamation in 1862 calling for every able-bodied man to enlist in the territorial militia. The men were needed to quiet the Sioux uprising, which had spread from Minnesota to South Dakota. Regular army troops were busy fighting the Civil War, so militia units were called on to keep peace in the plains. Nearly every man in the territory responded to the governor's call. 8 militia companies were organized. Few saw action. When the hostilities ceased, the militiamen returned to their homes. 4 years later, in 1866, Governor Faulk, feeling that the militia might be needed again, recommended to the territorial legislature that a permanent militia be organized. As a result, these 8 companies were raised from these counties. These units remained active for a time, but were eventually disbanded. In 1884, the Dakota Territorial National Guard was organized in 2 regiments, one from North Dakota and one from South Dakota, with headquarters in Bismarck and Yankton, respectively. In these early years, Aberdeen and Huron served as hosts to the Territorial Guard's annual summer training encampment. When statehood came in 1889, the Dakota Guard unit was divided so each state could have its own. These units saw little active military duty until the Indian Troubles of 1890. Then, they assisted the regular army in restoring order during the Wounded Knee Massacre. The years following 1890 were relatively quiet for the Home Guard. So quiet, in fact, that the legislature did not fund their operation. By the end of the decade, the need for South Dakotans to go to war prompted the reformation and funding of South Dakota's fighting men. In the harbor of Havana, Cuba, the Spanish sunk the United States battleship Maine. And in April of 1898, the President of the United States asked for 125,000 men to volunteer for the Army. We were going to war with Spain. South Dakota was asked to provide 1,000 men. Our National Guard units volunteered in force. They formed what became known as the 1st South Dakota Volunteer Infantry. South Dakotans also raised $11,000 for supplies and came up with an idea for soldiers on horseback. Sioux Falls attorney Melvin Grigsby convinced members of the United States Congress that cowboy volunteers would make an ideal cavalry regiment. 3 such units were organized: Teddy Roosevelt's Rough Riders, Torrey's Rocky Mountain Riders, and Grigsby's Cowboys. The South Dakota unit was officially called the 3rd Volunteer United States Cavalry. The regiment was made up of 12 troops of cavalry, many of whom were cowboys. 5 of the troops of Grigsby's regiment were made up of South Dakotans. South Dakota cowboys gathered at Fort Meade in early May to enlist. The units left South Dakota on the 23rd of May for Georgia, where the cavalry trained every day, hoping to be sent to fight for their country against Spain. Their wish never came true, and the war came to a speedy end. And by September, the unit was disbanded. On the other hand, South Dakota infantrymen did see military action. They had arrived in the Philippines in early September and were stationed eventually in Manila. There they performed the duties of an occupation force following the Spanish surrender. This rather peaceful duty lasted until February of 1899, when fighting broke out. A band of native Filipinos surrounded Manila and attacked the U.S. Army unit stationed there. The South Dakota infantry went into action immediately. from February 4th, 1899 to May 25th, they engaged the enemy for 126 days. When the fighting finally came to an end, the infantry had proven itself as a combat force. The unit was ordered home. 64 South Dakotans had lost their lives in the battle. When the soldiers returned to the United States, the state hired a special train to meet them in San Francisco and bring them on home. The unit was first welcomed at Aberdeen. South Dakotans from all over the state turned out in large numbers to celebrate their return. President McKinley even traveled to Aberdeen to join in the festivities. For the next 17 years, things were relatively quiet on the world front, so large numbers of South Dakotans were not needed to serve in the military until 1916, when Mexico found itself caught up in a civil war. Mexican bandit Pancho Villa joined forces with Francisco Madero to overthrow the Mexican government. The Mexican Civil War spilled across the border into the United States. March 9th, 1916, Pancho Villa and an army of 400 men raided Columbus, New Mexico. They set fire to the town and killed 21 Americans. 9 of them were soldiers in the United States Army. President Wilson could not let this challenge go unanswered. He ordered an expeditionary force of 4,000 men to go into Mexico and catch Villa. But the border raids continued, and on June 18, 1916, President Wilson called up the National Guard units to help police the Mexican-American border. The South Dakota Guardsmen were among the first called. They began assembling at Camp Hageman near Redfield on June 21st. Officially, they became the 4th Infantry and left for San Benito, Texas, July 31st. They arrived in San Benito 5 days later. The regiment's tour of duty for the next 7 months was to patrol the border and protect the civilian population. Their tour of duty was uneventful, but in November of 1916, the regiment participated in field maneuvers that would prepare them for the First World War. In February of 1916, the regiment left Texas to return home. War had been raging in Europe while South Dakotans were near Mexico patrolling the border. Up until 1917, the United States had remained neutral in the European conflict, but was forced to declare war on Germany. The South Dakotans who had served along the border had been home from Texas less than 6 weeks when their 4th Infantry Regiment was reorganized into the 1st Cavalry. Families across the state sent the men back to war with all the patriotism they could muster. 32,000 South Dakotans went to war, and those who didn't fight helped the war effort on the home front. South Dakota Governor Peter Norbeck appointed a state council of defense. The legislature, meeting in special session, passed laws requiring state schools to teach patriotism, and they prohibited the teaching of foreign languages, particularly German. Many South Dakotans responded to the patriotic spirit of the times by buying war bonds, working as Red Cross volunteers, or growing victory gardens so there would be more food for the fighting men in Europe. Over $5 million was raised in South Dakota to help pay for the war. But not all South Dakotans favored our entry into the war in Europe. The government was forced to take over the operation of the railroads to protect them from sabotage, and Senator Pettigrew was indicted for speaking out against the war, which is ironic considering the war was being fought to preserve concepts like freedom of speech. But war does strange things to people. And when the war was over, the case against Pettigrew was dropped. But in 1917, South Dakota's 1st Cavalry was on its way to Europe. 59 officers and 1,517 enlisted men went to war, representing Watertown, Pierre, Sioux Falls, Flandreau, Mitchell, Carthage, Huron, Clark, Britton, Aberdeen, Kimball, and Webster. The South Dakota infantrymen were joined with the Minnesota 136th Infantry. Many protests were raised about the loss of South Dakota identity, yet the orders remained. Several other groups of Dakota soldiers were able to preserve their identity. The 116th Supply Train was made up of men from Redfield, Madison, Howard, and Mitchell. The supply trains transported the tools of war to the fighting men at the front. The 147th Field Artillery Regiment had many South Dakotans in its ranks. During frontline action against the Germans, these cannoneers pulled the big guns into place with teams of horses. At one point during the fighting, the 147th had fired their cannons so many times, the barrels were worn smooth and had to be replaced. By the time the war ended, November 11th, 1918, 210 South Dakotans had died in battle. Another 100 died later of their wounds. When veterans returned home, South Dakotans were proud of their contribution to peace. As a reminder of their part in World War I, many soldiers donated war souvenirs to the state. The 147th Field Artillery Standard was displayed at the state capitol. Cannons were donated to local parks across the state as memorial to the state's dedication during the war. Some communities erected monuments to honor those who had given their lives. After the close of World War I, South Dakota was again without an identifiable military unit. Several years later, the National Guard was reorganized, and there was peace for over 20 years. And when the guns of war would sound again in World War II, South Dakotans would once more serve their country. But that's our next South Dakota adventure.